Amen. We say, amen. Amen. All right, tonight, get your Bibles out. I want you to go with me to 2 Timothy chapter 1. We're going to start there and launch out. And I want to minister a subject tonight called faith versus fear. Faith versus fear. You know, this weekend we were talking about fear, and it's so interesting that when you deal with a subject, oftentimes there's more to say about the subject than just what you can cover in, you know, a little point in a message or even in one message. And just like in the past couple of weeks, we've been talking about deliverance, and then Pastor Deborah came and launched off of that, and then this weekend we're talking about, fear and crossing the Red Sea, that sort of a thing. And I believe that God has something to say. I believe that God is putting his finger on an issue. And as I was meditating on this and writing some notes, it was kind of crazy because we had an experience in our home where one of our children came into our bedroom late at night. And they were afraid because on the television, it was talking about, in fact, the subject of the television program was somebody's history. And they found out that one of their ancestors was actually hanged in the Salem witch trials. Well, that just mention of the term Salem witch trials got the kids going, well, wait a second, what's this all about? Witches? You've told us we're not allowed to watch television shows with witches, you know? We're the parents that are like, no, you're not going to watch that, you're not going to touch that, you're not going to do that, you know? We're very careful about what goes into their spirits. Now, not only that, our children are like ultra sensitive, you know? So if they see something, they hear something, that, you know, it's like we're up all night with them. And so we've just had to put the brakes on certain things that we would think would be okay for them, but are not okay for them, you know? I'm saying? And so we because we like sleep at night. We don't want kids kicking us in the middle of the night in our beds and you know, doing the letter H thing. You know, that's where the two adults are sleeping like that. The kid somehow ends up like this, feet digging into daddy's back, right? And head is snoring on mommy. So anyways, we like to sleep. And so we just guard our kids' hearts as well. We guard our sleep. And so so here we are watching this program. And we told the kids, we said, listen, you guys, you don't need to be afraid of this. This is history. This is something that happened. At that time, people really did think that there were those that were among them that were practicing witchcraft. And they thought that they were witches. They thought that they were warlocks. They had trials. People, apparently, from what we understand from history, some of them were probably hanged unjustly, even though they confessed to one thing. They felt like they were coerced, thought that they would get off if they said that. And so here, it was just a very confusing time. And some things happened. And this is telling the story of one of those individuals who said one thing and then eventually recanted and said, well, no, it's not that way. I was just saying that because I thought I'd get off. And then eventually they were hanged because they figured out that, you know, what they decided was that they were deceived by the devil. And so our children, you know, understood that, and we explained that in their terms. But that night, one of our children came into our bedroom and was saying, you know, I just can't get that off of my mind. Every time I close my eyes, I see a skull. And, you know, we're telling this, we've trained our children, hey, well, what do you do? What do you do when you're afraid? We've equipped them. I was even asking them, okay, what are the scriptures? What do the scriptures say? What do you know? What have we taught you throughout the years of your life that how you combat fear? And they were able to go back through, but fear had so gripped their heart that they even though they knew the things that we were talking to them about and working them through, that fear had literally halted them from doing what they knew to do. I believe that oftentimes in our Christian walk as adults, see, because when we talk about fear, most of the time we go back to the stories about children, right? Being afraid of the dark and, you know, afraid of the unknown, and things are scary out there. There's an experience that happens. And oftentimes we think of it in childish terms when we think about, well, fear is something that we battle as children. But do you know that our fears, even though we may deal with those fears of being alone in the dark, we may deal with the fear of, you know, the bully on the playground, we may deal with those fears as children, that we grow up and fear changes. Now our fears become mature like we are, and they take on a new face. And if we allow fear to continue, it will cripple us and hinder us, even though we know better. Are you listening? See, there are two systems at work, and we live in a dual reality. Even though we live in the flesh, there is a spiritual realm that is all around us. There's actually two kingdoms which are at war. Now, we know that Jesus came and he defeated the devil. And so the victory is already ours. We live in a position of victory. But just like when a conquering nation goes in and conquers another nation, there's still that time where they have to incorporate the other nation. There's still time where the government is being set up and established. There's still the rogue enemies that are out there that are still fighting against the established victorious government. And so that's the exact position that we're in the kingdom of God. Jesus came and his death on the cross defeated the devil for good. Jesus came and he took the authority that the devil had usurped from Adam and Eve and he took it back, and now he has given that authority to the church. The church is now the governing, ruling, reigning authority on the earth. We are the body of Christ. Christ has delegated to us his authority. And so we live from a position of that victory, enforcing the rule and reign of Jesus Christ on the earth. Yet, we still live in a fleshly body. And we still live in the midst of a fallen system here on the earth. So there are two kingdoms. There's the kingdom of God, which we would consider also the kingdom of light. And as well, there's the kingdom of darkness, which we would consider to be the kingdom of the devil. Now, what moves things in these kingdoms, okay? The economy, if you will, what moves things is two different things in each system, in each kingdom. Okay, you guys tracking with me? Okay. In the kingdom of God, the kingdom of light, what moves things, goods and services, the economy of the kingdom of heaven is faith. Think about it. You believe, you receive, right? You get a hold of a promise of God. There is something that's available to you. Your faith reaches out and gets a hold of it in the supernatural realm and brings it as a reality into your natural realm. It's what moved goods and services, whether it be a provision or whether it be a healing or whether it be the wisdom that you needed. You moved that good, that service on behalf of yourself from God to yourself. How? Through your faith. Now, in the kingdom of darkness, there is an economy as well that moves goods and services. And that economy is fear. The devil knows that there is something that he desires, and he can move that thing by fear. In other words, if the devil wants to get you into a position of sin, he knows that he can't harm you himself, he can't push you himself, he can't tempt you enough himself, because God will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear. But the devil knows if he can get you out of faith and into fear, then he can move you into what he desires, which is a position of harm to yourself or to someone else. So we see these two systems at war, we see these two kingdoms, and we see these two economies, the economy of faith, moving goods and services in the kingdom of God, and the economy of fear in the kingdom of darkness, ruled by the devil. Now, we've taught our children, but I want to remind you, the scripture that we're about to read in 2 Timothy chapter number 1, verse number 7, was written to an adult. Hello. So this is not just something that we teach our kids so that when they're afraid in the middle of the night, they declare this and they speak this and they decree this over themselves so that they can go back to bed. This is something that we, when the mature adult fear raises its head and tries to move us into a different position than faith would have us in, that we can now take authority and we can enforce the rule and reign of Jesus Christ according to the royal law, the law of love that's written in his word. 2 Timothy chapter number 1, verse number 7, very familiar verse, but I wanted you guys to turn there in your Bibles. I wanted you guys to have it open. I wanted you guys to know the chapter and the verse. Why? Because Pastor Dan can't be there at your bedside in the middle of the night when you're scared. Pastor Luke won't be there on the job sitting next to you when you're reading the emails and you're concerned about your life. Pastor Jim and Deborah will not be there going with you to your family event and you're concerned about what you're going to do. See, we cannot be there, but the Spirit of God is with you wherever you go. And whatever you put in the Holy Spirit, part of his job description is he says, I will remind you of all things which I have said. So as you allow tonight the Word of God to go into your heart, it's like a library. Okay? That means there's a new book that's been placed in your heart so that when you encounter fear, the Holy Spirit's going to go get this book that's being written tonight on your heart, and he's going to open it up and he's going to say, 2 Timothy chapter number 1, verse number 7 says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but power and of love and of a sound mind. Now, I want you to notice something. First of all, is this. God has not given us a spirit of fear. That means that when you have a spirit of fear, it didn't come from God. So then the question that begs to be asked is, who then did this spirit come from? I think we know. It comes from the kingdom of darkness. It comes from the devil. Now notice that it is a spirit, okay? There is something behind that fear. This is not a natural fight that we fight when we find ourselves worrying and doubt and afraid. There is a spiritual thing that's coming against us. That's why I said you have to take authority and you have to enforce the royal law of love, the law of the kingdom of light, the law of Jesus Christ, and the word of God, which is eternal. You have to stand up against that thing. You have to confront it, and you can say, you spirit of fear, I cast you out in the name of Jesus. God has not given me a spirit of fear. He's given me a spirit of power, a spirit of love, and a sound mind. And I wanted you guys to see that in your Bible. Find out where it was so that you can dog-ear it, and I would challenge you to memorize that verse. Not just the words of that verse, memorize where to find it. Because there may come a time where you don't remember all the words to a verse and you need to get back to it. And that's why it's important to memorize the address as well. 2 Timothy chapter number 1, verse number 7. God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. Now, we know that we got this from the devil, and let me show this to you in the Bible. Turn with me there in 2 Timothy. Turn a couple books back to the book of Hebrews, chapter number 2. Hebrews chapter number 2 talks about where we got this spirit. Now, remember, Jesus said to people who were not yet renewed, not yet redeemed, people who were religious and who were coming against him and who were not embracing the kingdom of God, he said, you're of your father, the devil, okay? The devil had control. He had taken the authority from Adam and Eve and was ruling and reigning. And the Bible still says that he is the prince of the power of the air, ruling over this present age. Okay? So in Hebrews chapter number 2, verse number 14 and verse number 15 speaks more to this. It says, inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and of blood, he himself, speaking of Jesus, likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil. So we see that the devil was the ruling, reigning authority on the earth. But Jesus came and he lived in a body like we lived in. He came and he wore an earth suit like we have. And he died to defeat death because the devil had the power of death. But because Jesus was innocent and death is a punishment for sin, remember God said, the day you eat of it, Adam and Eve, you shall surely die. So the fact that Jesus died meant he's innocent. Now he qualifies as the sacrifice and the substitute for us. So since he died, we no longer have to die. That means that death no longer has power over us and we don't need to be afraid anymore. Okay? You guys following that reasoning? Okay, good. Because the next verse says just what I said. Look at it. It says that he destroyed him who had the power of death, that is the devil, verse 15, and released those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. In other words, when we operate in fear, we are now subjecting ourselves to bondage. No longer are we walking in the freedom that God has for us, but now we're being slaves. So I saw a couple of things. We're talking about faith versus fear, remember? I'm going to give you a couple of things that fear does. And on the opposite end, I'm going to give you a couple things that faith does. Quick little statements that show us what fear does and what faith does. And as we see these things, we're going to pull out some application. Okay, so it's all woven together, all right? You're going to be able to see what it does, what it is, and how it operates, and how you can operate in faith in your life. Can you say amen tonight? First thing, that was weak, by the way. I'm just letting you know right now. Going to have to say a better amen than that. Hey, can you say amen? There you go, there you go. First thing is this, is that fear deflates, but faith deepens. Fear deflates, and faith deepens. The longer we stay in fear, the smaller we become, and the more weak we become. Why? Because fear will deflate you. You ever thought, man, this is going to be a great day. You know, you get up, and you know, you're looking in the mirror, brushing your teeth, and you're almost pumping yourself up. Man, you got this today. big meeting at work, you know, you got a presentation you have to give, something like that, and you maybe you got a goal. Maybe it's a sales goal or something like that. There's something that you're looking at that day. And you're just pumping yourself, oh, I can do this. Man, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. I can go after this. I got this. Then you get to work finally, right? And all of a sudden, there's some bad news. Oh, they're having layoffs. Something's going on. And that fear steps in. Now, we have a choice. We can either allow ourselves to be deflated, or we can allow our faith to deepen. See, if we allow ourselves to be deflated and we allow fear to have power over us, then we will no longer be in a position to do what God has called us to do. And you will get smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. You ever had a balloon, like from a birthday party or something like that, that you kept for a long time in your house? My kids just love that, have a birthday party or something like that, and you got all the balloons, they're all standing up. After a period of time, you know, especially if it's real cold at night or something like that, you come down the next morning, they're all like hanging down, right? Kind of like that movie Up. Some of you parents know what I'm talking about because you've seen those Pixar movies more times than you want to admit. And the balloons start to sag down. They start to hang down. Why? Because they're deflating. They no longer have the power that they had because the pressure on the outside has become greater than the pressure that's on the inside. Fear will deflate you. It will take away the power that you have. And the more you give into fear, the weaker you become. And eventually, not only will you be deflated, but the devil will defeat you because now you don't have the power any longer. But the other option is to deepen your faith. In other words, when you encounter those situations where fear would like to try and move you out of that position of faith, rather than running from faith, you go deeper into faith. What does that mean? That means that you rehearse covenant with God. God, you said you'd take care of all my financial needs. I don't care if they're laying people off. They're not going to lay me off. And if they lay me off, God, you got a better job waiting for me, don't you? God, you're going to work all things together for my good because I love you, Lord, and I'm called according to your purpose. See, you go deeper into faith. That doesn't mean you hide your head in the sand and ignore the problems, you know. I've met people that won't even tell you how they feel because they think that that's faith. You know, hey, how you feeling? You know, they're in a hospital bed hooked up to a million machines. Oh, I'm blessed of the Lord God Almighty. His blood covered me, all this kind. And it's like, okay, I get that, but how are you feeling? Like, is there any pain? Oh, no, I'm not in any, you know, they're wincing. I'm not in any pain, you know. It's like, man, just tell me. I want to pray, you know, come on, I want to get into faith, but, you know, and if that's what you got to do to keep yourself in faith, I mean, praise God, but at the same time, it's not just burying your head in the sand. We can still look circumstances in the face. We can say, you know what, it doesn't look good. They're laying people off. And you know what, the prognosis is not good. They use the C word on me, Pastor, but you know what, I'm going to believe God that by his stripes I was healed. See, there's a difference. We're not ignoring problems. We're going deeper into faith. The Bible says in the book of Luke chapter number 10, I want to show this to you. In Luke chapter number 10, and Jesus is speaking to his disciples. He's sending them out. And he tells them something amazing. This just jumped off the page at me today. Luke chapter number 10. And in Luke chapter number 10, verse number 19. Jesus is speaking to 70 that he sent out, just returned. They're rejoicing. Even the demons have been submitted to their word. They're subject to them. In Jesus' name, talking about his authority. Jesus looks at them. He says, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Now look at the next verse, verse number 19. He says, behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. Do you know that's not just a word for the 70? Do you know that God contained this verse in the scriptures for you and for me today? Jesus is saying, I have given you authority. In fact, if you fast forward to the end of Mark, you fast forward to the end of Matthew, in the very last chapter, in the last couple of verses, you'll find Jesus saying, go ye therefore. All authority has been given to me. And go out there in my name, preaching the gospel. And then he says, casting out demons in my name. These signs shall follow them that believe. He says, and if you drink any deadly thing, it will by no means harm you. See, right here in Luke chapter number 10, verse number 19, he says, I've given you power over the enemy. I've given you my authority. In other words, you don't have to be scared of the devil. See, sometimes as adults, we don't think that we're scared of the devil because we don't really believe in the devil. Oh, that's just a childish thing. That's just something that, you know, the Bible talks about, but that's antiquated. That's old. That's not the real way it is. And the whole time, the devil's in the back laughing all the way to the bank. Why? Because he's moving goods and services because he's got you duped. And he knows that if you're ignoring him or you don't believe in him, he can continue to beat the snot out of you in the background, and you'll just keep wondering why God's being mean to you. Rather than deepening your faith in God, believing what God's word says, Jesus talked about the devil. The Bible talks about the devil all throughout it. From Genesis to Revelation, you'll find he's doing stuff. He's wreaking havoc on the earth. And all we have to do is to stand up in the authority and in the name of Jesus and say, no, devil, that's not how it's going to be. I'm not going to be in bondage to fear. You had the power, but it's gone. Jesus whipped you at the cross, and now you're a defeated foe. You are under my feet. Don't got to be afraid of the devil. You have the authority of God. You know what? If the devil's coming into your household, messing with stuff, making things happen, if you find out that something's going on and you just say, man, I don't know why we're fighting in our marriage so much. Sometimes people don't realize the devil is at work. Speaking lies and little whispers into people's ears. Well, they don't love you anymore like they used to. Maybe they fell out of love. Maybe you should get a divorce. And all of a sudden, in the midst of an argument over something else, well, maybe we should get a divorce. And all of a sudden, oh my gosh, they want a divorce. And then the devil plays with that. Oh, they want a divorce. Well, you wanted a divorce first. I mean, they're just not the way they used to be. They really let themselves go. They don't care about you. You should just walk out right now. You know what? I feel like walking out right now. And we don't even realize it. But the devil's at work. You take authority over that in the name of Jesus. And you tell that devil to get out of your house and take all of his antics with him and not return. But you can't be afraid because fear deflates, but faith deepens. George Mueller said this. He said, faith does not operate in the realm of the possible. There is no glory for God in that which is humanly possible. Faith begins where man's power ends. See, as your faith deepens, as you continue to inflate and pump in the word of God, to pump in the faith of God, to pump in the prayers to God, that as you do that, now all of a sudden you will rise like that balloon above every problem, above every trial, above every pressure. The pressure on the inside will be greater than the pressure on the outside. Amen? Amen. Second thing is this. That was weak again. I thought I talked to you guys about that. Let's try that again. Amen? Amen. There it is. Second thing is this, is that fear deafens. But faith defines. Fear deafens, but faith defines. See, we're often powerless because we listen to what fear is screaming at us. See, have you ever been in the midst of a problem and all you can look at is the problem? All you can think about is the problem. Maybe you had a conversation with somebody that didn't go the way you wanted it to go. You had a certain thought, you had a certain way going into it that you thought it was going to happen. And then afterwards, you walked away from that thing and you said, man, that wasn't anything about what I thought of. You know, they didn't listen, they didn't hear, nothing happened that I wanted to happen. And then you go and you try and pray, and all of a sudden you're back to thinking about that conversation. No, no, God, I'm going to pray. And so you start to pray, and then what happens? You're back to that conversation. Okay, well, maybe now's not the time to pray. I'm going to go study the word. I'll be fine if I read. And as you're reading, all of a sudden, you're back to that conversation. Why? Because it's screaming at you. The problem is constantly talking. The devil is constantly slinging arrows that come in thoughts and attitudes, in intentions, motives, things that are coming in, feelings and expressions that come at you. It's battering. It's like waves of the ocean beating against the shore. It just keeps beating and beating and beating. And all you can hear is that roar. And yet if we can quiet ourselves and not allow faith to deafen us, or fear to deafen us, but rather faith to define us. See, the fear is screaming something at us. You can't do it. You can't make it. You're not smart enough. You're not nice enough. You're not kind enough. You made too many mistakes. There's no going back. You've done too much wrong. Who do you think you are? You think you qualify to be used by God? You think that you can be a godly man? You think that you can be a godly woman? Fear will shout at you, and it will deafen you to what faith is speaking. See, God's word is there too, and God is speaking. But how many of you have read in the Bible where it says, a still small voice? God's saying, I want you to just tune out what fear is saying. I want you to get quiet, and I want you to listen to the gentle whisper of what God is speaking to you, because that will define who you are. God says, you're an overcomer. He doesn't have to shout it at you. All he has to do is speak it. Because his whispers are more powerful than the greatest shouts of the enemy. Hello. Let's take a look at this in the Word of God together. You got your Bibles there in the book of Luke. Turn with me back towards the end of the Bible. If you hit Revelation, you got a little bit too far. 1 John, okay? 1 John chapter 4, verse number 18. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 18. Let's take a look at what God is speaking over us. 1 John chapter 4, verse number 18 says, "There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear, because fear involves torment." Some of your translations say punishment. Remember that your punishment was already placed on Jesus at the cross. And now you're headed for heaven. Hell is the place of torment, right? So fear is a hellish thing. It's from the kingdom of darkness. But if you operate in the perfect love of God and you allow the love of God to come in and define who you are, then there will be no fear. Now look at the end of the verse. It says, "But he who fears has not been made perfect in love." Now, made perfect means made completely equipped, fully outfitted. In other words, when we operate in fear, we're lacking. We're now no longer spiritually sensitive because we've been deafened by the blast of what fear has been shouting at us. But when you operate in the love of God, remember, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power, of love. Oh, wow. And of a sound mind. So here, the love of God now comes, and if we allow the love of God to define us, then now that love will cast out fear. In other words, I don't have to be afraid in my adult life of what people think of me. Should have had a bigger amen than that. I don't have to be afraid of what people think of me. I don't have to keep up with the Joneses, whoever they are. Apparently, they live on everybody's block, because when you look out and you say, "Man, they got a new car. I wish I could get a new car. Oh, they painted their house. I wish I had money to paint my house. Oh, they redid the lawn. I would love to redo the lawn. They're putting in a pool. Where did they get money for that?" Right? But listen, you don't have to keep up with the Joneses. Let me try this side of the room. You don't have to dress to impress everybody. You don't have to look, ladies, you do not have to look like the CoverGirl model. You don't. Husbands, please tell your wives they're beautiful. And when she says, "Well, I don't feel beautiful," let her know beauty is not a feeling. I told my wife the other day, "Oh, you look cute." She goes, "Well, I don't feel cute." I said, "Well, cute ain't a feeling." It's not. See, if we can operate in the love of God, we know God loves us, God accepts us. Now, God's not going to leave us the way we are. He accepts us the way we are, but he's not going to leave us that way. We're growing in God. But if you mess up, you don't have to be afraid. Take it to God. "God, I messed up." See, sometimes we're afraid, and fear will deafen us. God's going to reject you if you tell him you messed up. No, God wants you to go. He already knows. He was there with you when you did it, telling you, "Don't do it. Don't. Hey, stop. No. Put it down. Put it away." And we ignored him. And then we're afraid to go and tell him what we did. He already knows what we did. And he's just waiting. And if you'll come, the Bible says, and confess, then he's faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God will lead you, and he will teach you how not to do it again. See, if you're afraid of, "Well, I'm afraid of God chastening me." No, listen, God is not going to torment you. He will discipline you. Why? Because discipline's good for us. But in our society, we've turned that around. We say, "Oh, don't discipline your kids. Don't discipline anybody. You can't discipline on the job. Nobody should be shouting at anybody. You shouldn't be mad about anything. You shouldn't have any emotion. You should just be stoic and just float through life and let everybody do what everybody else wants to do." No, that is not the way of God. We're so afraid of offense. We're so afraid of discipline. We're so afraid of these things. And yet, you're going to be a weak, beat up Christian if you don't go to God and don't get disciplined and don't grow up. God doesn't want a bunch of carnal baby Christians. God wants mature, growing, healthy, strong, victorious Christians that are disciplined. He's building an army, not a kinder care. I better get going. Fear deceives, faith delivers. Fear will make promises that it cannot keep. If you buy that, you'll be looking good. Everybody will like you. Can't keep that promise. Faith delivers. You need provision? God will take care of you. May not look like how you want it to look like. May not look like a Rolls Royce and a house on the hill, but God will provide. And in the things that matter, it'll be better than a Rolls Royce. Amen. Someone once said that an acronym for fear is false evidence appearing real. You guys heard that before? Fear. False evidence appearing real. See, faith deceives. Fear will deceive you into thinking something is real. It will build structures. It will build cities around you. Fear will try and tell you that it's so great, so awesome, so mighty. Everybody's doing it. Everybody thinks this way. Everybody's going to hate you. And you're going to be in this city of fear with no way out. But if you walk up to the walls of fear and take your little pinky finger and poke it through, you will find out it is just a front. All you got to do is blow it over with the word of God, and the whole thing will come crashing down. See, because faith delivers. See, in our lives, we deal with the fear of man. We deal with the fear of the unknown, deal with the fear of future. We deal with fears as grown-ups that we didn't deal with as a child. Fear of not being able to pay the bills, fear of not being able to perform, fear of letting down our spouse or our children, fear of letting down the job or the boss or whatever it is. There are fears, and each and every one of you in this place, you can look at your life and you can say, what am I afraid of? What hinders me? What when I hear about it, deafens me? What deflates me? What stops me? And what is there an area that I'm deceived in? And bring those things to God and say, God, I want to get in faith. I want to stand on your word, which says that I'm loved, which says that I have the power of God, and finally, which says that I have a sound mind. See, the word for a sound mind in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 7 is a compound word. It can be literally translated from the Greek, a saved mind or understanding. You ever heard the term safe and sound? Right? We understand that. That's really what it's saying. You have a safe and sound mind. In other words, your mind has been renewed because you are saved. And then you are sound. In other words, there's no shaking. There's no misunderstanding. You have a safe and sound mind. In John chapter 14, verse number 27, I'll just put it up on the overheads for time's sake. John chapter 14, verse 27 says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. It's a choice. He says, don't let your heart be troubled. Don't let it be shaky, but let it be a sound mind. Let it be a stable mind. And he says, neither let it be afraid. Jesus gave us his peace. We don't have to be afraid any longer. We don't have to be crippled by fear. Faith will deliver on its promises because they are based on the word of God. God is looking after his word to perform it. Do you know that if God didn't perform what he said in this word, that he would have to give up his throne? Because that would make him a liar. And if God's a liar, then he has to give it all up. So God will never fail you. When you get a hold of the word of God, you get a hold of a promise, you believe God at his word, and you incorporate that into your life. Pump it up. Get stronger in faith. Grow in faith. Deepen in faith. Allow faith to deliver on the promises of God, moving goods and services in the kingdom of God. Last thing for tonight is this, is faith delights the heart of God. Hebrews 11:6, without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. See, when we live a life that's pleasing to God, his rewards are eternal. God will reward you when you operate in faith and when you shun fear, when you get out of fear, when you don't allow the devil to put you in fear, when you get in faith, now all of a sudden you're living a life that's pleasing to God. I don't know about you, but I want to put a smile on the face of God each and every day of my life. I want to live a life that when I enter into heaven, I can see not only the pearly gates, but God's pearly whites. Hello, right? I want to put a smile on God's face so that when he sees me, man, big ear-to-ear grin comes on his face. Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord because you believed God at his word. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give the Lord a great big praise tonight. He's good. Amen, amen. Hey, I want to talk to you guys about your life before we leave this place. I want to ask everybody to remain seated during this time. No one get up, no one leave, all right? Unless you're one of the leave early section people that's running out to one of the tents to serve the people. Everybody else remain put. Okay, I want to talk to you about your life. It'd be a tragedy if we came into this place tonight and had such a good time hooting and hollering, shouting about the Word of God. It'd be a tragedy if some of you guys in this place even got healed. Man, we had a good time praying, and maybe you felt that acceptance of God for the first time when we talked about rejection. But it'd be a tragedy if we did all that and you left this place and your heart wasn't right with God and you died and you went to hell. Torment, like we talked about, and you didn't go to heaven to a reward. Some of you guys in this place said, well, Pastor, you've been talking about faith. I believe in God. That's great. You know, the Bible says the demons believe in Jesus. They know who he is. The Bible says also that they tremble. Everybody look up here. Give me some of your attention real quick. Look up here. This is not about what you have in your head. It's not about mental ascent towards God, knowing who Jesus is. Sometimes people think, well, you know, I've not only known about Jesus, I've done something with that. You know, I've been a good person, lived a good life. Used to be bad, cleaned up my act, now I'm good. You know, giving money to charities, help out my neighbors, been a really nice person. I believe that God's going to let me into heaven because I've been good. Do you know that nowhere in the Bible say we can be good enough to get into heaven? It doesn't work like that. You can't be good enough to get yourself into heaven. Not going to make it. Sometimes people think, well, you know, I was raised in church. My parents told me we were Christians growing up. They hung a cross or St. Christopher around your neck, had you baptized or christened as a child. And, you know, you went to Sunday school or catechism class, maybe Sabbath school class. You're born in America. America's a Christian nation. Everybody born in America is going to heaven. We're not any other religions. We're not Buddhist, Muslim, Hindus. We're Christians, right? Wrong. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're raised in church and your parents tell you you're a Christian, that makes you a Christian? It's not there. Sometimes people think, well, Pastor, okay, I understand that, but not only when I was a child did I go to church. Here I am sitting in church right now. I consider myself to be a Christian. And while I'm glad that you're here tonight, do you know that nowhere in the Bible say you can sit in a seat in a sanctuary, warm up a spot, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian? That's like me saying, I want to be a car. So I go to my house, I sit in the garage, and I call myself a car. Nope, just a dude sitting in his garage, right? Can't just sit in church, call yourself a Christian, that makes you a Christian. Sometimes people think, well, okay, I understand all that, but you know what? My last church, I got involved. You don't understand. I helped out. I sang in the choir, volunteered, made decisions. People thought of me as a leader. Taught in the Bible class. I didn't get a membership card to that church. Well, that's wonderful, and I'm so glad that you got involved in your church, but could you just show that to me where that gets you into heaven? Because it's not there. God is not looking for your volunteer hours or your membership card to a church before you can enter the gates of heaven. Jesus said it like this. He said, if you want to enter the kingdom of heaven, you want to go to heaven, here's how. He said, you must be born again. Now, I know. Our society's made a mockery out of that term. They raked it to the coals, made it out to be something that it's not. And yet, this is not about what society says, Hollywood movies, books, television, and the internet. You know, they're going to tell you one thing. Let's let the Bible define for us what being born again is. What does being born again really mean? Well, from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible, it's always meant the same thing. Means you've given God all of your heart and you've given God all of your life. Just that simple. It's all or nothing with Jesus. Let me prove it to you. Last book of the Bible, book of Revelation. Jesus is speaking to the church. Wow. Just like he's speaking to us here in this church tonight. He says, when I come, I want to find you hot or I want to find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I'll vomit you from my mouth. Gross, graphic words from the mouth of Jesus. But what's he saying? Lukewarm, what's that all about? Well, it's a little in, little out, little up, little down, little token prayer every now and again. An occasional church attendance. God is something in your life, but he's not everything. You're not opposed to God, but you're not wholehearted for God. Listen, if that's your relationship with Jesus, not going to make it. How do I know that? Because only people that are not real Christians will be ejected and rejected from the body of Christ. So tonight, I'm going to give you this opportunity. In a moment, I'm going to count to three just like this. One, two, three. I'm going to pop my hands together. Bang! When you hear the sound of my hands popping together just like that, bang! That's your opportunity to raise your hand. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, I want to give God all my heart. I want to give God all my life. I want to be born again, headed for heaven, denying my presence in hell. I'll see your hand go up. I'll count it. You give it right back down. You might be thinking, whoa, 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 wait a second. Time out. If I raise my hand, I'll be embarrassed. Yeah, but are you going to let fear deflate you and cripple you and keep you out of the kingdom of God? Or are you going to operate in faith, believing the word that you heard, that if you will give God all of your heart, give God all of your life, being born again, that you can go to heaven? What are you going to choose tonight? Probably won't even be embarrassed, but even if you are, it's better than ending up in hell. I'll guarantee you that. So who should raise their hand? If you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm speaking to you. Who should raise their hand if you're not sure about your salvation? Tonight is your night. Make sure. Who should raise their hand if you've never done this? Never giving God all of your heart, never giving God all of your life. I'm speaking to you. Or finally, who should raise their hand? If you're lukewarm in this place, you know that's the condition of your heart when I describe it. Get ready to get your hand up all across this auditorium, back in the family rooms, wherever you're at, watching by television in the foyer, down at the Love Rock Cafe. Come on, you ready to get your hand up? Then tell an usher or come into the church service right afterwards. If you're online, wherever you're at, get ready to get your hand up. God sees, God's watching. He'll see you right where you're at. And then you can minimize your video browser, click the button that says respond to God, or go to our homepage, How to Know God. You'll find that tab. Click on that. Someone will lead you in a prayer. I'm going to count to three. Pop my hands together. This is your time. This is your moment of salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Just raise them up high for me right now. If that's you, thank you. There's one. God bless you. Who else today? There's two. There's three. Got you over there on this side. Who else today? There's four. Got you right there, my man. Thank you. There's four wise people already. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? Four. Is there one back there? There's four wise people already. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? If I saw you, you can put your hand on, but otherwise, come on, get it up high for me tonight. If that's you, anybody else real quick? Thank you. Got you right there. Thank you. Five. God bless you. Who else today? It's five wise people. Anybody else real quick that I did not already see? Anybody else? Thank you. I got you already. Thank you right there. Anybody else? There's about five wise people. Anybody else real quick? I want to make sure that you don't miss this opportunity. You've missed enough opportunities in your life. Don't let fear hold you down right now. Come on, be courageous. God loves you. He's accepted you. Sent Jesus to the cross just for you. Anybody else? You're sitting there wondering if you should do this. Yeah, you should. Go for it. Go for it. Anybody else real quick? I'm going to wrap this thing up. Just one more sweep through. If that's you, just raise it up high when I'm looking in your direction. Anybody else? Anybody else? Thank you. Number six, God bless you. All right, let's give the Lord a great big praise for about six wise people. Hallelujah. All right, all six of you, number 7, 8, 9, and 10, you should have raised your hand, but you didn't. I want you to know it's not too late. Here's what I want you to do. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible, a friend if you need a friend. I want you to get your stuff, in other words. Get in the aisle and meet me up front, because we're going to change destinies tonight. Can't do that until we get you down here. Let's all stand and welcome them. If you raised your hand, or you should have raised your hand, you come right now. Come on down to the front. Come on, come on, come on. They're coming. Let's give them a hand as they come. You can come too. Come on, from the family rooms. If you want to bring your children, you can come right now. Come on. They're still coming. You can come too. Anybody else? Just come on right now. Nudge your neighbor. Say, come on, friend. I'll go with you. Hey, you guys up front, you guys came. Praise God. Best decision of your life right here, all right? God's going to come in and change everything from the inside and work its way out into your life. So good. So good. Right over here to my right, your left, this is Pastor Joel. He's a good guy. Nothing weird's going to go on. You already got past me, okay? I'm about as weird as you're going to encounter tonight, okay? He's cool. He's going to do three things. Lead you in a prayer to invite Jesus in your heart. You're going to be born again. Give you some free literature, some free information. Find out what to do next in your walk with God. And then he'll give you what we call a spiritual personal trainer, okay? It's a friend in church who'll help you get strong in the ways of the Lord. So you don't go back to your father, the devil. Remember that guy? Hey, you died to that, all right? You got a new daddy. His name is Jesus, all right? New brother and new family, okay? Brand new start. So that spiritual personal trainer is a friend who will help you to follow it through with the decision that you're making tonight. He'll describe how it works. It's easy. It's free. You need to do it, all right? And then he'll let you come right back out. You guys make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right this way. Let's give him a hand. Hallelujah.